Hey, what's up now?
Brother, what's up?
This is a big party, man.
Yeah,
I
brother,
can dig it.
Stop right on.
There's too many of you crying. Brother, 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 there's far too many of you dying. You know we've got to find a way.
Hello, hello, hello. This is the Power Lunch with Dr. Rich. We're going to be talking about some issues. I'm going to be trying to feed your mind. I think that the intro song, What's Going On, is pretty much appropriate for what's going on today. It's funny, and it lends some validity to my stance on nothing really has changed. As we are looking here, one of the lyrics that Marvin said was, brother, 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 there are far too many of us dying. And, you know, quite frankly, we've been dying for a while. You know, there's been a lot of people who have given me some feedback on Facebook to show that my stance on Black Lives Matter and the stance on these cop killings and the stance on people trying to kill cops is not changed, and it should not be at all linked together. But if you look at it from a standpoint of what's really going on and the people that actually come to me and say, well, this is the problem, and the problem is Black Lives Matter, then we've got to talk. We've got to talk. So basically, this is Dr. Rich. I am what I like to call edu-activist. I am here to try to bring some awareness or at least start the ball rolling on exactly what's going on. I am a college professor. I am a father. I'm a Christian. I'm a man who just tries to do better. I like to send a shout out to my friends out there. This is the first show. I want to say hello to my buddies, Greg and John and my mentors, Norm Harris, and my little son, little Preston. Little Preston, if you can see me, this is your daddy, boy. So I'm trying to make it better for you so that you won't have to go through some of this stuff that your dad and people like your dad are going through. So if you want to call in, you can call in to 504-65-ON-AIR. Again, the number is 504-65-ON-AIR. Okay, let's get right into it. What we know now. What we know now is we have three dead police officers in Baton Rouge. The week before that, we had five dead officers in Dallas, and the days before that, we've had two African-American males killed, seemingly on air or on television or on video or in our faces. And we look for answers, and everybody goes, well, this is what's going on from the Black Lives Matter standpoint, and this is what's going on from the police's standpoint. And I think we need to actually just take a step back and try to understand exactly where we are and what we can do to actually come up with some solutions. What we can't do is we can't come to the table looking for a solution by saying you're wrong and I'm right, and this is what's going on, and you need to change. That's not going to happen, people. Conflict, we know, starts. It doesn't just start from something that you see. It starts from a criticism. There are four stages to conflict. The first stage is criticism. The second stage is defensiveness. The third stage is stonewalling, and the fourth stage is contempt, where you're just contempt. You're just tired of the conflict, and the problem is when we look for solutions, sometimes we do the same things that we ask the other person not to do in an effort to make them change. Let me explain something to you. You cannot change anyone else, period. The only person that you can really change is yourself. So a lot of people are probably thinking now, well, Dr. Rich, what do you mean when you're talking about change? What do you mean when you're talking about changing myself? Well, when I'm talking about changing myself, I'm talking about changing your thinking and changing your life. Now, I'm not telling you at all to accept anything that's going on. I'm not telling you at all to make things right. I'm not telling you, I'm not giving you an excuse about one should erase the other. I'm not telling you anything like that. But what I would caution you on is taking a side and asking for objectivity. There's no way you're going to be able to get to a solution, a true solution, if you sit on one side and ask for objectivity, or you ask for everyone to be objective. And this morning, early this morning, I posted something on my Facebook page, and I talked about the fact that we now have a dilemma. We have an issue. And these three words have tended to give us so much hell that I think the thinking has gone out of the window, and the emotions are what we're actually working on. And so the first thing we need to probably do is take a step back and find out the facts and find out if we're actually looking at it from an ethnocentric or an egocentric point of view. And I think we need to actually figure out the problem with our thinking in trying to figure out a solution. So when we talk about this, a lot of people bring up Black Lives Matter. And let me explain something to you. When I hear the three words Black Lives Matter, I see no indication. I don't make any kind of bones about it. If Black Lives Matter, then they matter. Whether the police are doing the killing, whether black-on-black crime is doing the killing, whether abortions are doing the killing, I don't care who's killing black lives. I just care that they need to stop. Now, how then are we going to be able to get to a situation where we look for solutions if the only thing that we can say is Black Lives Matter? Because if I was somebody who was not black, I would look on the other side, which is this is part of the critical thinking epithet, is to think about the other side or being fair-minded. You have to think in your mind, well, if black lives matter, then don't they matter all the time, regardless of who's killing it? And I've had countless people try to explain this to me. I don't get it. I try. And I'm, again, being a black man, I'm not speaking out against one side or the other. But I will tell you this. Until you've walked a mile in someone else's shoes, you don't have any perspective. You don't have any experience. And there's a lot of people out here who talk about, well, the cops should do this and the cops should do that. You know, a lot of people used to do that when we were in the military. And when I went to war, everybody goes, well, why did you go over there? They did it to the Vietnam vets. Why did you go over there? Why did you do this? And they served not a day in the military. So if you don't understand, if you haven't walked a mile in my boots, don't talk about what's actually going on in my shoes. You can't do that. So the first thing we need to do is to stop blaming one side and stop blaming the other side. If you've never been a police officer, you don't know what police officers go through. If you've never been a person who's been assaulted by a police officer or who's been stopped by a police officer, then you don't know what people are going through. What we need to do is actually come together and say, there is a problem. Not say, you're wrong, I'm right, I'm wrong, you're right. No. There is an issue. The issue is too many people are dying by the hands of police on some issues. Too many people are dying on the hands of each other. Too many people are just dying, period. Too many people are not looking for the solution, and they're looking for a complaint base or somewhere that has to actually, something that actually has to something, someone to actually blame. And a lot of times we don't have anyone to blame but ourselves. You can't go out and try to clean up the streets if your house is not clean. Again, call in live, 504-65-ON-AIR. Again, the number is 504-65-ON-AIR. Now, as we talk about this solution, I want to go down the list here. We talk about this solution. Let's get this out. What we're doing now, not working. Protests, not working. We're not doing anything but inciting riotous behavior. Protests are not working. We're not being effective. and we need to actually do something different. Now, what are we supposed to do different? I don't know. Maybe go out and vote. Maybe get a firm understanding. Maybe get a firm understanding of the laws. Instead of having a march in the streets, how about we go and look at what we have to clean up in our own streets? Try to understand the law. Now, when we talk about understanding the law, everybody goes, well, what are we supposed to do? Well, let's first understand the law. Let's read the Constitution. Let's actually go to a law library and actually look up the laws that govern our towns and our cities and our counties and our states. I can tell you now, the Texas State Constitution is a very large document. And if you really want to have some reading, go try to read it. It's long. But what happens if we all get together in a united front and go to the law libraries and sit there and read about the laws and read about the things that we have on our side? Now, people, when we do that and we start to understand the rhetoric, I just saw something on ESPN, a feature on ESPN about day before yesterday, and they were talking about a cop who had been acquitted for shooting a young black man 12 times. He shot him 4 times, and he went on to subsequently shoot him 8 more times as the individual fell on top of him in a ditch. Now, from the dash cam that I saw, the young man was there. Firstly, the background on that was there was a young man, and this happened in, I think, 2013, 2014, 2015. There was a young man who went out with his friends. He came home. He dropped his friend off in an affluent neighborhood, I guess. And when he was leaving, he had an accident. The story is he went to bang on someone's door, and in that banging sequence, the young lady inside, who was a Caucasian woman, stated that someone was trying to break into her home. And she gave the full description of the young man, and the young man happened to be black. He had to have on a green shirt. When the police arrived, 2 cars arrived. Here's the guy walking down the street, nothing in his hand, nothing, no threatening pose or anything. When he was stopped, the film on the dash cam shows 2 red marks from the taser, as far as 2 red marks on the taser to show that they had the taser aimed on him. He saw that. He started running. He ran off out of the view of the dash cam, and you hear 4 shots. Boom, 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 boom. The 4 shots happened, and you heard 8 more shots. A total of 12 shots. So fast forward, and they're in court, and the police officer was actually stating some of the things that were really in the law. He said, I was fearful for my life. He said, I did not stop firing because he did not stop advancing. And in the law, that's pretty much what it is. That's what the law says. So if we have a problem with how the law, well, first of all, a lot of times they don't get to court. If we have a problem, then we probably need to understand the law. And if we look at it from the standpoint of understanding the law, the legislators that we vote for are the ones that actually make law. In the United States, legislators make law. The people in the judicial branch interpret the law. So we can't really say we can get upset because of the fact that the law that is written is being interpreted correctly by the judicial branch of the government. So if we want to change that law, we need to actually go in there. But before you can change that law, you probably need to know what that law is. Now, that big word, change, and word, period. We want to talk about words. We talk about change. Words. Words, hands up, don't shoot. Words, he's got a gun. Words, don't move your hands. Words, officer. Words, stop. Words, get on the ground. Words, I can't breathe. These are the things that we look at. Words, Black Lives Matter. Those are 3 words that are probably in the past, I guess, year, are some of the most controversial words that just incites anger in one, on one side, it incites anger on the other side. And I think the I think the aim of the movement gets lost in translation because of those three words: Black Lives Matter. Well, now we have a black cop who was shot by a black man. Now what are we saying? Are we saying, well, we're not talking about that side. We're just talking about the police who are shooting black men. Well, wait. You can't have it both ways, okay? It's Black Lives Matter. Now what do we have? We have a problem. We have a black man who shot a black cop. A black cop is dead. And from my standpoint, two more black men died. And the census doesn't care. The census says, well, instead of 13 million so-and-so-and-so, now there's 13 million and 98. Okay? So we can't go there. If we're going to make a blanket statement about black lives mattering, then they need to matter every time. Now, when we talk about words and we talk about change and we talk about understanding the law, we need to actually understand what we want to change from the beginning. So you can't ask for change on one side and not be willing to change yourself. Now, I can tell you now, being an educator, I can tell you that an undisciplined, untrained, uneducated mind kills way more people than any bullets ever can. Bullets, yep, they kill. They kill whatever you fire at. Whatever you fire a bullet at is pretty much destroyed. But an uneducated, undisciplined, and biased mind can kill a whole lot more. And we look at it, and we look at it from the standpoint, I have a five-year-old son, and he's a black boy. And he will be hopefully he will be a black man. And I have to teach him how to understand what's going on around him, much like my father had to do for me. There are a lot of things that my father talked about, one of which was you have to try three times as hard to ensure that you get what you need because of the fact that things are going to be hard for you. That was the talk. Okay, now the talk has to be something different, but remember, words. Son, you're going to have to try three times as hard because things are difficult out there. Story doesn't really change. When you look at change and trying to change yourself, you have to try to figure out why you feel the way you feel, and how you're going to change yourself in order to help change the situation. If every time something comes up, you scream racism, people, that's not going to work. And it's so funny about words. It's about, you look at the media does it, we do it. It's real funny. In New England, when there are a lot of rabid sports fans, over-anxious sports fans in New England who turned over cars and busted out windows and got arrested and set things on fire, they were ravenous sports fans, according to the media. In Ferguson, those were thuggish rioters. Now, that's kind of weird how the media looks at it. And if we're talking about change, we need to talk about ourselves, but we need to talk about the media. Now, you're probably asking, well, Dr. Rich, we can't change the media. Nope, sure can't, but you can sure change how you react to the media. If the media shows you something, you can't just go and look at it and say, oh, that's racial. This is what's going on. Because on July 4th, a man named William Patterson was killed in South Carolina. On July 4th, white man, William Patterson, killed South Carolina by police. Didn't hear about that, did you? No, you didn't. But you did hear about the black guys that got killed. These are the things that you have to understand. The media sometimes shifts our mind. But if you're an undisciplined, untrained, uncritical thinker, then you automatically go to the side that you most relate to. Well, that was a black man. This is what went on. Okay, since I'm in that group of people, I'm going to be with them. Whoa. Wait a minute now. Because when Pookie and Man-Man And I don't want to hear this crap about, well, when Pookie and Man Man kill each other, Pookie and Man Man go to jail. No, they don't, because no one in our neighborhood snitches. I don't want to be no snitch. Right. Right. That's why you can't catch Pookie, Man Man, Ray Ray and them, because no one talks and no one snitches on Pookie, Man Man, Ray Ray them. But Pookie, Man Man, Ray Ray and them have shot 15 little boys, 15 young fellas in that neighborhood since you've been alive. But you don't want to talk about that. But you'll go and riot and loot and tear your own neighborhood up because Officer Wanowski killed Pookie and them. That makes no sense to me. If someone can call me and explain it to me, I would listen. But I do not understand how in the hell one black life outranks another black life when they're dead. 504-65-ON-AIR. 504-65-ON-AIR. Call me, talk to me, chat with me. Chat with me. Some of you people out in England, watch onairlive.com. If you get on, a lot of people are saying that they can't get on. I don't know what the problem is. I'm on watching myself. So I think what you have to do is wait for the advertisement first, and then it'll actually come on. Watch onairlive.com. You'll see an advertisement first, and once that advertisement is up, then it will allow you to see me. And here I am. Hello. All right. Let's get back to this thing about change in the media and how we react to things. The issue in Dallas a couple of weeks ago, last week, hurt my heart. It was devastating to see that. I didn't understand. Hell, I don't understand any black lives being killed, but I didn't understand the whole deal as far as, you know, going back at the police. And the funniest part about it is people, there's two things you're not going to get rid of in the United States: the United States military and the police department. Hang it up. And if you expected President Obama to come here and say, I don't want the police to shoot black people, you were wrong. He didn't come here for that, because, see, President Obama relies on the people that have guns, that take guns to work. He relies on them to protect him. So if I were the president, I wouldn't have done that either. I wouldn't have gone up there and been like, these policemen probably shouldn't have killed all these other people. And I'd have looked around, and those people that were talking about that would have been walking away. And I'm like, whoa, wait. You know, you got to understand, you know, he's not just the African-American president. He's the president of the United States of America. That means everybody. So let's talk about how to change. We talk about that. We talk about how to change. How do I change myself? Well, what you can do is you can look at yourself and figure out if you're thinking fairly. Well, how do I figure that out, Dr. Rich? Well, the first thing you do is you get to work to an intellectual trait of intellectual humility. Okay, so the first thing we need to do is have some intellectual humility. We have to have, in order for us to be a critical thinker, we have to have a firm grasp of what we know and what we don't know. Now, a lot of times in my classes, I tell people, you know, I tell my critical thinking students, go home and find two people that you know fairly well. On the left side of the paper, write down what you know about them. On the right side of the paper, write down what you don't know about them. Every time, out of every time, students come back to class and go, you know, I've never sat and thought about what I didn't know about my mom. Yeah, it's a daunting task. You can do it right now. I'll wait. Since we don't have any commercials, so I'm just going to do this so we can have a commercial interruption. Okay, so now we've had that, so you guys can go out there and actually look at your side of the paper of people that you know fairly well. Let's talk about your mother. What do you know about your mother on the left side? What don't you know about your mother on the right side? And you're probably thinking, well, Dr. Rich is crazy. No, this is called an exercise in intellectual humility. Another thing you have to have is intellectual empathy, and this is a big one. You have to actually feel for someone who's not you, who's not like you, who doesn't worship the same God, who doesn't sleep with the same people, who doesn't go to the same church, who doesn't eat the same food, who doesn't look like you, sometimes doesn't even use the same language, but you need to understand that they're people. There's nobody out here who wants someone dead as far as a police officer, because they've got to go home too. They have wives and children and their sons, their nephews, their grandsons, and they don't want to die no more than you do. But when we get out into this world and we see these things, the first thing we want to do is grab something negative, and we use the wrong words when we do. So one of the things that I would ask for you folks to do is stop using the word race when you talk about something that's this inflammatory. And you go, well, wait a minute, well, what is that? And a lot of people are quick to call someone racist. I dare you to go look the word up, racist. And when you look the word up and you find out, oh, well, you know what? They probably wasn't a person who was racist. But you gave them, you judge and jury, charge them, call them a racist, and that was it. So you have to kind of change that. So why don't we say something like ethnic background? Because do it yourself. How do you feel when I say it had to do with race? Now, what if I tell you it had to do with ethnicity? Something about that word race, and I think that the media has forced us to do this kind of stuff and kind of get us off our rocker. They kind of do things, and you got to understand, the media is going to play whatever gets them paid. Okay. The media is going to play whatever gets them paid. At 2:30 in the morning on that night, that fateful night that young man took those five lives and RIP to those officers in Dallas and Baton Rouge and Sterling and Castile, RIP to those folks, and my prayers are with them all. Because in all of that, a lot of people lost loved ones. But when we looked at that, we saw at 2:30 in the morning, we were still on the air showing this is what happened. This is what happened 6 hours ago. But Channel 5, Channel 4, Channel 8, were all CNN, Fox News. Everybody was on this deal, because this is the thing. This was the flavor of the day. This was the thing that actually got you paid. And the same thing with this, same thing for Ferguson, the same thing for anything that's making news. And we got to understand, we have to wonder, why is it that violence makes so much news? The tragedy in France, tragedies in France make the news. And you see everybody on your social media, you know, pray for France, pray for this, pray for that. Okay, here's what I want us to do. If we're to truly change and we're to truly get upset about black lives, what I want us to do is get just as angry with the school boards, with the neighborhoods, with the communities, with our own criminals. Just get just as downright angry with them as you do at the police when the police take our lives. Now, if you can't do that, then I don't want to hear you with Black Lives Matter. I don't want to hear it. Stop talking to me about Black Lives Matter, because you didn't care about Black Lives Matter when Pookie and Rayway were killing each other. And, yes, I keep hammering the same thing home. So how do we fix it? We go vote. We start to change. But I think we need to go to a deeper level on this. In Dallas, you can give at any given time. I can go down to a Dallas school right now, pick one. Skyline, something, I don't know, A-Mesia, any of them. And look at the campuses, at the buildings, at the facilities. And you see that they're so run down, and they have they metal detectors everywhere, and the neighborhoods around them are not that great. We need to figure out how to, number one, upgrade those. I've gone to schools that have trailers, literally. Dallas School District, don't get upset with me. Dallas Independent School District, don't get upset with me. But you have children in temporary learning facilities. Is that what we call them? They look like trailers to me. temporary learning facilities. They look like trailers, and or portables. I have an editor here. They're called portables. Portables. You're educating children in portables because of the fact that you didn't do enough planning to effectively build your schools. Now, parents, you ought to be upset about that. Because here it goes once again. Well, we don't know why this is going on. I'll tell you why it's going on. Because from K through 6, K through 5, K through whatever elementary is in the state of Texas, these children have to go to school. Half of them are hungry when they get there. Okay? Half of the teachers don't – some way, I can't say half. Some of the teachers just display a don't care attitude. Some, and there are some, oh my goodness, I've met so many teachers that do really give a damn about these children, but they don't have the resources to give the children what they need. I spoke to a scientist, yes, a scientist who works in one of the schools, who actually teaches her children about science, can't get an electron microscope. She can't get a microscope, an effective microscope, to show her fifth graders about science. Why? That doesn't make any sense to me. And if you want to figure out this whole deal about children when they turn 18, 19, 20, 21, how about fixing the facilities that they learn in when they're 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, and 12? Eric Erickson's theory of psychosocial development says that children learn to learn through the ages of 6 to 12. That's where we need to start pouring our money. But then again, wait a minute. Dallas parents, if and I think in the state of Texas, here in the state of Texas, our homeowners' taxes go to the schools. They fund the schools. So I think what it should be is a DISD special vote to have something redone as far as the allocation of dollars to the schools to make a major renovation to schools. If your school in Dallas doesn't look like if your son's school in Dallas doesn't look like my son's school in Frisco, then there's a problem. If the ones in Highland Park don't look the same way in Dallas, that's a problem. But whoa, that's not Frisco's problem. That's not Highland Park's problem. That's Dallas's problem. If that's the parents' problem, if you are sending children to school who have no respect for authority, that's the parents' problem. Yep, you had them. You can't just go ahead and have them and tell them that you're going to just send them to school and let the parents babysit. That's not how that happens, okay? Because when they get to college, to me, I don't babysit them. If they don't know how to write a paper in APA format 6th edition, I'm sorry. But Bobby Jones, he's about to be mad as hell at Dr. Rich. Because I'm going to give them a D. Here's the deal. Let's start changing by changing our schools. We educate our children the wrong way. We're not teaching them how to be critical thinkers. We're teaching them a test. And I'm sorry, people. I don't understand how you can teach someone a test. No child left behind. Okay, fine. If they don't know 2 + 2, they need to be left behind. They need to be left behind until they learn. And here's the deal. The elementary school educators, you know, they get upset with me, but I'm sorry, need to figure out a way to alternatively educate individuals, especially these children. I mean, these children have social media. They know how to use tablets. My 5-year-old son has a tablet. He's gone through three of them already. Well, he's working on his third tablet now. And they just get on the tablets and scroll through, and they understand how to do these things. And it's funny because we didn't have that when we were growing up. I had an Atari. I think that was kind of different. But anyway, you know, we need to get to our children to start demanding from our elected officials that our schools get more money. Why is it that our schools in Dallas don't have enough money to upgrade their facilities? I don't get that. Dallas, if someone from Dallas DISD can call me right now on 504-65-ON-AIR, it's 504-65-ON-AIR. If you can call me now, and let me know what's going on with that. I would love to hear it. Why do we have so many portables at the Dallas schools? Did no one do any planning So we look at the population demographics, and we know how people our people are growing and the number of children that we have. Why in the hell don't we have schools that can educate them? And why don't we have teachers that can educate them? If you can tell me why we pay judges more than we pay teachers, I'd be willing to listen. If we pay judges more than we pay teachers, but the judge is the one that actually has the damning effect on the child. And a lot of times people remember their teachers and not the judges. So the first thing is make a change. The second thing is change our perspective. The third thing is change our schools. We need to fund our schools. And that's going to take a little work from both sides. That's not a thing where some manna from heaven is going to come down and the state of Texas is going to come down and give the Dallas Independent School District or any other inner city school district in Texas a big grant of money and say automatically, voila, you're fixed. It doesn't happen. Parents, you need to jump around and act a fool and get as angry as you can peacefully and go down to the school board and speak to those individuals who are not funding the schools, speak to the individuals who are in charge of the schools, and figure out why we can't get better education, better books, better teachers. Get the teachers out that don't care. Get the teachers in that do. I know some teachers. I have a great friend of mine, Duchess Britton. She's a great teacher, G-R-E-A-T teacher. She loves her children. And she educates her children. There's a lot of people out there who love their children that come to them, but they can only do so much. They can only do what the parents allow them to do through their taxes. If you're voting to not have your taxes raised because you want to keep more money in your pocket, then how can you expect your schools to actually grow? And this whole concept of, well, we'll just get it from the richer neighborhoods, I'm sorry. Nope. Mm-mm. That's the handout method. I don't want a handout. I want to do it on my own. 504-65-ON-AIR. 504-65-ON-AIR. I'm here. Or you can call 214-660-JETTA. I don't know the rest. 660-5321. Got it. 660-5321. You can call in live. I'll put you on the radio. Now, wait a minute now. You get on the radio or you get on the show, just remember, it's live and in living color, and we don't have a bleeper or a censor-er or anything like that. So be respectful of all of us and the young folks that might be listening. 504-65-ON-AIR. Change the way you think. Change the way you look at the media. Change your perspective. Change the schools. Change the schools. And if I have any educators out there that can call in and tell me what's going on with the schools, then I would love to hear that. But we need to realize that there's a problem, and it starts with our young folks. And our young folks are seeing all this stuff on the news. And they it's almost like you want to turn the news off when your children are in the room because you don't want them to hear, well, this person that today in the news – today in Dallas, someone goes in and shoots up a club at 2:30 in the morning. Really? Do we really want that? But again, however you have this information coming to you, you need to be able to effectively translate and think about it and be able to take the emotion out of it. That whole Black Lives Matter, or whoever you guys are who created this rally, so this peaceful rally that you said was, and hey, everybody has a right to protest. I'm not telling you haven't. But whoever had this peaceful rally where this man shot these five cops in Dallas, I would ask that the very next time something like this happens to where someone gets shot by the police on television, that you take a 72-hour moratorium. What does that mean? Don't do anything for 72 hours. Now, some people say, well, time is of the essence. Uh-huh. And now think about the last time you got in an argument and you slapped the hell out of somebody because you were pissed off at them. And if you probably took 72 hours to think about it, you probably wouldn't have done that. So I just ask the leaders of these organizations who are crusading for the good fight and doing all of this kind of other stuff to protest in the streets, I ask you that the next time, because there's going to be a next time if we don't change, the next time something like this happens, I want you to have a 72-hour moratorium. I call for a 72-hour moratorium in everything that you do. And I've had to learn this. My mentor, Norman Harris, has told me a lot of times that sometimes if I get so hot, if you pour water on my head, steam will come through, meaning I will get so mad that I could probably chew through nails. But he also taught me that, son, you can't react to everything you see, and you have to sometimes take a step back. And sometimes the best thing to do is not say anything. But I bet you if we took those same amount of people and showed up at a law library in Dallas and walked in that law library peacefully, got a book that had to do with the law, sat down and read it and read other cases that had to deal with what we dealt with, closed the books after we finished reading for an hour, came out of the law library, went somewhere else and convened about how to change this, I bet you all of a sudden we would get a whole lot more traction on what we're doing as opposed to Black Lives Matter, being in the street, acting a fool with posters. Yeah, I'm sorry, people, that doesn't work. In the 1960s, it worked for 2 minutes until they let the dogs out and the water hoses and shots and tear gas and all that kind of stuff. I get that. I understand your position on that. But now that we're a little bit, we have a lot more education, we have a lot more technology, let's do it the smart way. Let's figure out this solution on another level. If you're upset with the way the laws are, change the legislators. If you're upset the way the police are, change the police leadership. If you're upset of the way things are doing, I tell you what. A lot of people have a lot to say about what the cops are supposed to do, but they've never been a cop. Have you ever been on a cop ride-along? If you've never been on, and I'm not talking about ride-along like watch cops. But no, I'm talking about get in the vehicle and ride along with someone on a beat as a police officer. And you see the number of times that their lives are put on the line because somebody just decided to not take their medication that day. Somebody watched a clip on CNN and decided I'm going to shoot some cops today. They crazy. Don't they have the right to protect themselves? I would say yeah. Just because you're a police officer doesn't mean that you have to accept everything that a criminal is doing. I'm sorry. If I was a dog catcher and I knew that there were two rabid Rottweilers out there, and I run up on two rabid Rottweilers in the middle of the street, I'm not going to go up and go, "Hey, little puppy, come here." No, not doing it. Sorry. Not happening that way. Okay? 504-650-NAIR. You know, it's real funny. I have no callers. None. No callers. Okay, well, we're going to keep talking. I'm going to go here. If we don't have any more callers by 1:15, I'm going to go ahead and end it. But I'll be back next week, and we'll talk about some more stuff. If you guys want to have something, you want to have a fireside chat, I ask all the commissioners, I ask the police chief, I ask whoever to come out and let's talk about some of the things. I ask any police officers to come out here and let's talk because, hey, man, you know, dead police officers, that's not good, all right? Shooting police officers, not good. That's not the way. You don't get revenge. Vengeance is mine, saith the Lord. So, you know, going out here shooting cops, that's not the way. That's not the way. I don't care what you say, how you justify, whatever. And if you get upset about black lives being dead, then you need to get upset about every black life being dead. I challenge you to do that. If you get that angry about a police killing a black man, you need to get that angry about Ray Ray killing a black man. If you get a police killing a black man, you need to get angry about a black girl having an abortion. If you get that angry about police killing a black man, then you need to fight for education for your children so that they don't go out and do the same kind of things like what? And everybody goes, well, they weren't doing anything. They were just walking around. Yeah, you're right. You're right. But that's not always the case, and we need to be honest with ourselves about that. We need to be angry about our neighborhoods. If you see somebody out on the corner slinging that crap, then you need to go ahead and say something to them. And if you're afraid of them, then you need to tell somebody you're afraid of them and have them do something about it. You can't just go around talking about, I ain't going to do no snitching. And another thing, you know, a lot of people talk about this cop stuff and this, hey, if I'm killed by my brother, don't you think that's way worse than getting killed by somebody who's not my brother? My brother's in the house with me. If he shoots me, and I've trusted him and put him in my house, and he shoots me, you can't tell me that's not more devastating than somebody who's off the street who doesn't know me who shoots me. I would think that the person who shoots you that looks like you is way worse of a crime, the way more than a crime. And then education and the lack thereof. People, the only way we're going to make it in the United States is be educated. And people say, oh, Dr. Rich, you can say that because you have a doctorate. Yeah, well, they didn't give it to me. It took me 6 years to get my doctorate. In those 6 years, I did a lot. It took me 6 years to get it. So I've been through some things. I'm ex-military. I was in the military for 10 years, 6 months, and 2 days. I went to Desert Storm twice. I've been in corporate. I have over 30 years of leadership experience in 5 different industries. All right? I talk about this stuff all the time because it's near and dear to my heart, because I'm a black man raising a little black boy who might be that guy. Discipline your children. I discipline my son at 5 because at 15, I don't want him in your house because the Frisco cops don't love him like I do. People, I'm having if you want to know about changing your thinking, changing your life, on the 29th of July at 11:30, I am having what's called a lunch and learn. If you go to my site, www.drprestonrich.com, if you go to my site, you'll see the lunch and learn. The tickets are $25. It's a lunch and learn, and it's talking about critical thinking, to change your thinking, change your life, and be able to take charge of your future. I will have a session. It's called the Rich Session 1 of 4 in the Rich Thinking Series. This is a series of talks that I will have throughout the DFW Metroplex, talking about how to change your life, change your thinking, change your life, and to take charge of your future. I have 3 more to go. They're already developed. If I have any restaurant owners out there who would like to host a lunch and learn, it can be a dinner and learn. I just basically want people to be able to eat while I'm talking and talk while I'm eating, you know, that kind of stuff, so that we can have that. Because as I found in my 30 years of leadership and being in charge of people, I found that when I take people to lunch, well, I'm not going to be able to take you to lunch. When you actually come to lunch and eat, when people are eating and sharing food with one another, they get to talking a lot. So I would really like to have that. Again, it's a lunch and learn. It's in Plano, Texas. It's on the 29th of July at Del Frisco's Grill in Plano, Texas. Del Frisco's Grill in Plano, Texas, and the Shops of Legacy. People, it's $25. We're going to have a great time. I want you to come to my lunch and learn. It's called Critical Thinking. Critical Thinking, Change Your Thinking, Change Your Life. Taking charge of your future. You can get tickets online. If you want to follow me, you can follow me at DocRich1. DocRich1. You can get me at www.prestonrich.com or www.drprestonrich.com. You can also hit me at Facebook, Professor Preston Rich. People, I'm coming back next week. I want to hear from you. I hear a lot of people out there having a lot of opinions, but I want to hear from you. I went 45 minutes just talking, just myself, and you know I can go. So, you know, my students always know about that because I can go an hour and 15 minutes without taking a breath. But I want to hear from you. I'm here as a change agent, an edu-activist. I'm here as a person who wants to help my folks, and I want to help other people understand my folks. And I want to help my folks understand themselves. Always remember, Dr. Rich loves you, and I'll see y'all next week.